The relationship with sir is something very, very personal. I've known him as my teacher. I came here as a student. I came to the Yoga Mandiram as a student because I've always had asthma and the related skin problems, you know, like from childhood. And it went away, like when I became a teenager or something, I was completely free of everything. And I fell in love with a person who belonged to a different religion. And I'm talking about 1980s, you know. So in those days, the society was very closed. And I had my mother and his mother telling that they're going to commit suicide if we go ahead and things like that. But anyway, we went ahead and it took us 5 years to convince them that we wanted to get married. Although now some days I do think I should have just given in to it. After 31 years, I do wonder, was it really worth it? No, it was worth it. No regrets, but I think that kind of took its toll. And finally we got married after 5 years of deciding to get married. And because my mother fell ill, and then she was convinced that I would be all alone in the world and things like that, because my sisters were against the marriage, because their husbands were against, because their children couldn't get married and so on. So all that, so my mother put a foot down and said, if you're marrying this person, go ahead. So anyway, to cut a long story short, we got married in different ways, you know, like we had to get married this way and that way and the government way and every way. And after the final marriage, we were so exhausted, I just slept after a long time. And in the night I got up having, we did not know what was wrong. I was rushed to the doctor and the doctor asked me whether I have asthma, but I did not remember that I am asthmatic. So then of course we started going to the doctors for the treatment and it started getting worse. So every time I was going to hospitals and oxygen, and those days it was steroids and all that. So one of my friend's friend, she told me she had the similar problem, and she came to Krishnamacharya Yoga Mandiram, and there's this person who is really good. You must meet that, the son of Krishnamacharya. So I called up for an appointment, and they gave me one appointment. I think it was something in 89 December or something. And I couldn't make it because I was sick. I was in the hospital. So we called up and said, not able to come. And then, so they said, sorry, after 2 months. It's all full and you can come in February. February also the same thing happened. March, it was, you know, it's very easy for me to remember, it was 3rd of March. So I came on 3rd of March, and this lady who gave the appointment, she said, I'm sorry, you made a mistake, you should have come yesterday. And you know, like, this is a person who's suffering. I could hardly you know, sit in a comfortable position, and I had driven myself and come. So I made a big noise. I'm not a person who makes noise, but you know, kind of that that kind of broke the camel's back. So I made a noise, and this person came out to the consultation room and asked what's happening. So I didn't know, he was looking a very simple looking person, you know, dressed in the Indian style. And I said, you know, this is terrible, this is the third time I'm trying to get an appointment, and if you don't see me today, I will never again come back. And he said, no, who told you? Please, you must come. And these other people were telling there are other appointments, you know, but he just took me inside and then he asked me what was the problem. So till then I've been going to doctors and telling them my problem, and you know, like halfway through, okay, then so do you get up in the night, do you have problem in the night, you know, like they finish it, they don't listen to what you're saying. But here's this person, that was sir, And sir, listen to me. And I think about 15 minutes non-stop, I must have just spilled out all my emotions, you know. And he listened to me so patiently and he said, I'm going to give you a teacher who's a doctor and you're going to get, and I asked him, everybody said that this is not going to get better. And at that time, it was about 5 years after my marriage, you know. So he asked me, you have children? I said, no. So he said, he asked me why. So I said, we're trying and nothing's happening and lots of treatment. But it, and then he said, that could also be one of the reasons why you're getting these frequent attacks. And so he put me on to this doctor who was a yoga teacher. And every week I was supposed to come and I came faithfully. And initially, before coming to Mandiram, I had gone to many places. And I could do the headstand, you know, my body became very flexible. I could do all the asanas. But my breathing problem continued. So here I was asked to do like arm movements and then say ma and oh and all that, you know. And I used to tell my husband, I don't think this is going to work. But anyway, I'll give it 6 sessions. So because I live quite far away, so I have to drive up, come here. And my teacher is very strict. If I'm like 10 minutes late, she says, sorry, you come next week. I have another class. So she would go away. After about 4 classes, what happened was, and sir, I would meet sir every time I'm going, he's going home. So he would ask me, how are you? I don't know, I'm the same. I always used to tell the same reply, you know, there's no change. And after 4 classes, some people had come home, and this asthma had become so bad that if I burst out laughing, it would end up in an attack, you know. Like you just, at the end you don't get your breath and then you're struggling. And we didn't have the inhalers and all that in those days. And cooking also, you know, you had to be very careful, keep all the windows open, nothing should be there which would go into your nose and obstruct your breathing and so on. So after about 4 classes, some people had come over and they were telling a joke. And my husband said, wait, let her go away. Let her not listen to the joke. Because, you know, if I start laughing, I would end up with an attack. But nothing happened. I was bringing the tea in and I listened and I laughed and nothing happened. And after they left, you know, we looked at each other and we said, whatever. For us, it was expensive. I mean, it was 35 rupees those days, but 35 rupees was a fortune for us, you know. Like, we had living on one salary and all that. So he said, it does not matter what the cost is. Please go. This is working for you. And that's how I stayed in yoga, you know. So the next class, I came and I told my teacher, I feel much better. I mean, I was very positive. And when I went out of the, when I was going out, I met sir. And he asked me, have you applied for the diploma? So I said, what is that? He said, your teacher didn't tell you. I said, no. He said, she's a director of studies and she did not tell you? I said, no, she didn't tell me. He said, go back and meet her and ask her. So I went and asked her. Then she said, no, tomorrow's the last date. Don't have to apply. I don't think you'll get it. But I think sir put in a word for me or something. So I applied and they kept asking me, everybody in the interview board, they kept asking me, so you're going to teach yoga? So I said, no, I'm not going to teach yoga. I've improved so much by doing yoga that, you know, I got interested in it. So, and sir kept brushing them aside, you know. He said, no, we'll see. And I got into this diploma thing, and after about 2 months, I just started attending the classes. He asked me to, somebody came with asthma, and he said, I will give you the course, you have to teach them. So I said, I didn't even know how to draw, you know. So he said, you learn how to draw and take the class. So we started teaching. I mean, not only me, there were a few of us, and of course, we were very short-staffed in those days. But what I'm trying to say is he had this intuition, you know, to find out, first of all, to listen. For me, as a student, when I came in, that's what struck me the most. Because you go, even later on when I was had bigger illnesses, whenever we go to doctors, I'm not bringing them down because I come from a family of doctors. Both my parents are doctors, sister, brother-in-law, everybody is a doctor. But this is something which we all learned. As yoga teachers, we learned from him how to listen. And whatever you say, whatever the student says at that time is the truth. So if, you know, like somebody comes and tells, I have sat with him during consultations, and when somebody has said that I can hear some holy person, Shankaracharya's voice in my ear, he's never laughed it or brushed it aside or anything, you know. So he used to just ask, what did Shankaracharya say? And after, when we were training, doing consultation training with him, he used to tell that you have to accept what they are saying. Because for them, that is the truth at that point of time. It can change later on, and that's our aim, to bring him back to a state of normalcy. So I became a teacher there, and so my relationship kind of underwent a little bit of a change. I became a teacher under the big teacher. And I learned, we were asked to come at all hours to come and sit with him to observe students, how he takes class, how he does consultation. And every session with him was a revelation, I mean, for me. I come from a different culture, so I had this thing, and also living with a Brahmin, his family is very orthodox. So they used to keep doing these pujas at home, you know, like somebody falls sick, they say, oh, somebody's cast eye, so we should do this puja. And if you go abroad or, you know, you start a business, you have to do a puja. And it was getting to me because this was not what I thought my life would be. And I had pressure from my family because, you know, when I go and tell my mother and my other people who were close to me, oh, you're becoming a Hindu. Sir asked me to do chanting. I had a lot of resistance to that. Mainly because of this, because all these pujas have a lot of chanting. And so in my heart, I was thinking I will also get turned into a Hindu by chanting. Then what happened was, once I got a very bad attack of wheezing, and he gave me some shlokas to not chant, just to say as I am breathing out, I had to say. It's actually the Gayatri mantra, but he camouflaged it in such a way that it did not appear to be Gayatri mantra. Many years later I realized it was that. And he made me use the force of pronunciation, you know, the Mahaprana, where you have to stop and say, take a breath, say that. And I found a lot of improvement in that. So I went and told him, the whole class was given one teacher to learn chanting. So I slid into the class. Initially I had not joined. I joined there, and then I realized I didn't know Sanskrit. So I went and joined Sanskrit college. I did two courses there. And not that I'm good in Sanskrit or anything, but at least the pronunciation is all right, yeah, in chanting. And I got fascinated by that. And also by then, of course, I had come to grips with myself that doing something is not going to turn me into anything which I don't want to be. So I'm grateful to Sir, because I think I've told him this also. It is coming for yoga here and being a teacher and teaching chanting to very orthodox Brahmin people. He used to make me the teacher for them. And it helped me to have a successful marriage. I mean, like, you know, I realized what is in the relationship, you know, that what is between my husband and me is different from other people in the equation. So that's how this 32 years has been going on. So it has helped a lot. And of course, I took to chanting and I enjoyed. Even today, I go to Mandiram only to teach chanting. I don't take any other class because basically you can prepare for chanting and you can go. So I enjoy that. About, I think, a few 10, 12 years later, I was diagnosed with, I felt little, I mean, I went and told sir that I'm not feeling okay. And he has this gift of doing the nadi. You know, he will just put his fingers on your wrist. And I think like your whole history and your previous life history will come to him. So he said, why do you say that you're not okay? I said, I don't know, I just feel that I'm not all right. So then he said, did you go for any medical checkup? So I've gone for everything. I've done a master health checkup. I've gone to a family doctor, everything. Everybody said, I'm fine. And he was giving me lots of, herbal things, like with gooseberry and drakshavla rasayanam and all that. He said, take it, there's too much heat in your body, you have to bring it down. I have a feeling that he knew what was wrong with me, but he didn't want to say it. Finally, I went to a gynecologist, and I was wondering, because I don't have children, maybe it's early menopause or something. So she found a small lump in my breast, and which was always there. It was a scar tissue, but she said it's better, you know, I was 43 years old, so she said, remove it. So I went and told, this was that silver jubilee of Krishnamacharya Yoga Mandiram, Kaustubh was taking over, lots of things were happening, everybody was busy. So I just met sir and asked him, she's telling to remove the lump, what do I do? So he said, you have the strength to go through with it. I mean, he did not, every time you go to him, say, sir, I'm scared of this, no, nothing will happen. But this time he said, I mean, this is all, you know, with hindsight, I've kind of thought over what did he say when I said this and all that. But he said, no, you will get over it. You're a very strong girl, you will get through this, don't worry. So I went, we got the biopsy and it was malignant. But with the grace of God and I think sir's blessing and all that, it was in that 0 to 1 stage. So, but my sister had already had it, my older sister had it. So they said it's better to do a partial mastectomy and all the lymph glands and everything. My sister was abroad when it happened. She was working, she's a doctor, so we had no contact with her. And for us, for my husband and me, basically we were alone. We did not know how to handle it. And I remember I came with the report with my husband to see sir. And nobody was saying anything, you know, we just gave the report and he read it and he chanted something and I didn't feel better for the first time. And even when he put his fingers on my wrist, I didn't feel better. I was devastated. But when I was leaving, he said, I'm going to be with you. And he was, I mean, like when I was admitted in the hospital, he came to the hospital, he sat there for a long time with me. And after the surgery, he came. And when he came, they had brought coffee. So at that time, he said, now you can have, but later on, you can stop having coffee. Let's not put any more pressure on your liver. And you wouldn't believe it, that was the last coffee I had. I didn't have coffee till about 2-3 years back. So how I got through that was basically sir talking. Every other day I would call him and I would talk to Menaka and Menaka would give the phone to him. And or he would call me back if he's not in a class, and we did not know, you know, what is chemo. And 2001, it was very new then. Now it is very common, everybody knows what is what, But I didn't even know that chemo is given as an IV and you lose your hair and, you know, all kinds of things. So when the first hair loss came, I landed up in Sir's house. And he said, nothing to worry, you're going to get better hair. This is very superficial, I've been telling you. We have to be worried about things inside. These superficial things don't matter. And when we came to the radiation, it was four chemos, and then we had this 33 radiation. So every week I would come and see Sir. I couldn't, because they had done the surgery to remove all the things, the lymph nodes and the 3/4 of the breast was removed. The left side, the mobility was much hampered. So he started giving me, he said, you can do some things. They gave me a physiotherapist. And when I was in the hospital itself, they started that, you know, the physiotherapist was just pulling the hand and the tears would just come out, you know, said, and if you don't do it, then you're going to get into trouble. You'll never get the mobility back. So I came and told Sir, and he said, no, when you're all right, when you're able to come in the car to my place, we will make it all right. So it became all right. In fact, this hand is much better now than this hand. It's slimmer also, because I still do the exercise which he's given me for this hand. And the diet, he was very strict. So he said, like, no milk products other than basic buttermilk. He asked me to avoid cheese, paneer, and all those things, and fatty food. Because basically it was to avoid the strain on the liver. So we finished the treatment, and he gave me, I told him I'm ready to come back to teach, but then he said, we'll wait for 6 months, because you know, when you teach, you give something of yourself. So there has been a lot taken out of you. And we will wait for it to come back. And then you can start giving. Because teaching is a giving experience. And that was a big lesson for me, actually. Because we do it, you know, automatically. We don't think. Sometimes you feel exhausted, even physically, if you don't exert yourself. But end of the day, like after seeing 3, 4, 5 students, you are very tired. It's because something of you has gone out. I mean, to help, to heal, to help in the healing process. So I think 1 year of my life, I was not in the mandram. After that, I came back. And he put me straight into, you know, teaching the diploma, take a class for the diploma, because the confidence had gone. Your appearance is different. I had put on a lot of weight because it put me on steroids. And initially, I tried telling Sir that, they are giving me steroids. He said, just go with whatever they say. Don't fight anything. Just accept whatever they say and get over it. I think other than my husband, he was the one constant factor in me. It's not easy to talk, you know, about him, because it's like a part of your heart, and to take it out and analyze it. But I realized that I should do it because other people should benefit from it. So I was just thinking, what can I say about Sir? I mean, I'm too little to talk about Sir. He's like a giant, you know. And what appeals to different people is, one is his ability to listen. The other is ability to accept everything, whatever is there. And then he had the knowledge and the confidence to know that he could change it, or to help in the process of change. You can't do it unless a person is willing. But definitely, that's why anybody, I mean, I remember I used to go and teach in Schizophrenic Institute, you know, the SCARF. And I mean, what hope can they have? I mean, those doctors used to tell, what hope? I mean, do you really think yoga will help? We don't know. But there were a lot of improvements by doing yoga regularly. We could make out so many things. They were able to express themselves so much better. So many improvements, which I'm sure Kaustubh will tell you what are the benefits of doing yoga for all these people. But with my own eyes, I've seen that. And once we had gone to this place where they have these special children. Nowadays, that's the correct term, right? So he had taken me and another colleague to, we were supposed to teach the children yoga. But when I saw these children, like, I mean, I don't have children, I love children. I just couldn't bear to see the children in that state. And my blood pressure shot up. I had severe headache. And I went to Sir the next day and said, I've got terrible headache. And he did the nadi magic and he said, you're having high blood pressure. And what he did was, he didn't give me the children. He asked me to teach the mothers of the children. And actually that healed me, and I think the mothers also benefited from that, because I had so much empathy for the mothers. So, I mean, this kind of intuition, and I think it comes out of really caring for the people, you know. He has told us many times, when we were doing our diploma, he has told us, unless you really like people, don't come to teach yoga here. We are not teaching a set of asanas and pranayama and, you know, like do 100 sets of Surya Namaskar and you will achieve your goal. It's not like that. We are going person by person on a one-to-one basis, and you have to really like the person. Otherwise, this is not going to work for you or for that person. And unless we, the teacher, is convinced, it's not going to be conveyed in the healing process. Then no healing will happen. And that is something which, you know, basic tenets of Mr. Desgaja's teaching, that is. And everything is individualized, everything, every single thing. We cannot teach even a Sheetali pranayama to a group of, I mean, we are forced to teach a group of students, but in individual classes, it is individual. And the other thing which struck me the most was his innovation. If somebody is not able to do something, we can do something which will bring some result, which can again take him to that place. So much of innovation, you know. I remember somebody had done a consultation for a student, and I was very new at that time. I was asked to teach that lady, and when I was teaching, she got fits. And in her fits, she used to bite her tongue. So we didn't know what was the problem. I saw the blood coming out and her head went somewhere, you know. And I just panicked. So when I came out, fortunately for me, sir was there. So he was talking to somebody. I just took his hand and took him inside. I said, I thought it's an emergency situation. And he sat there and held the wrist and he said, no, you're fine. You go and bring water. And basically, I was trying to make her do Sheetali because that was the instruction, and I was too new. I did not know that I have to check whether they can do what is given. And then he asked her to open her mouth, and we found the tongue was bitten. A part of the tongue had gone. So he said, no, she can't do Sheetali. He told her, you're going to be all right. And she was one of my students, I think for 4 or 5 years she was coming. And we just modified. We did not have to teach Sheetali or Sheetkari or anything, but she improved so much. And the fits, the seizures, the number of attacks reduced a lot. So that innovation, I think even Sri Krishnamacharya started it, but sir has taken it to very high levels. I mean, anything. This morning I called my husband and I said, I have to go and speak about sir. And I'm, I'm really out of touch addressing people and all that. I just have 3 or 4 students to teach Shanti. So he said, about what? I said, about sir, my experience with sir. He said, my God, sir, I can never forget. I said, what do you remember? He said, he loves to play tennis. And then he got this tennis elbow. So when we went to a family doctor, you know, the first thing what doctors say, stop playing tennis. So then the elbow will recover. So, and he was not happy about it. He tried giving up, but then he and he makes his unhappiness very known. So it's not comfortable to live with such people. So I said, you come and meet, sir. And he didn't have much regard for yoga and all that, other than, I mean, like, he is a very active, go-getting person. So he thought it's meant for people like me, very slow and all that. So I brought him to the mandiram to meet, sir. And I had explained to sir what was the problem and all that. But of course, sir did not heed anything I said. He asked him, what's the problem? Sir, I have this elbow pain. And he said, oh, they are calling it tennis elbow. So sir said, why should they put any name to that? What is the thing? So he said, I'm not able to do this movement, but I can do this. And he said, I play tennis. So he asked him, do you want to play tennis? He said, yes, I want. It's a part of my life. I don't want to give it. Okay, don't give it up. We'll work around it. And till today, that elbow problem has never cropped up again. But he's very, every day he does his yoga, even more diligent than I am. So he ensures that his elbow, you know, that's the approach he had. He would ask you what you want. And I remember so many people, when we sit for consultation, they would come and say that they are having acidity, but they can't be without having their evening drink. And you know, what is it? So it's scotch on the rocks and things. But he's but if you said you should not take it, then I'm not interested. No, I'm not going to tell you to stop drinking. Please have your drink. But we'll see what we can do. And he would, you know, make some modification somewhere else in the diet. And he would ensure. And then they're having 3 drinks. When they come after 3 or 4 classes, he, you know, he would ask the teacher, now how many drinks is he taking? So he has only 1 drink. And the same thing with smoking. Many people have come and said, we smoke, we can't stop it. And don't have to stop. But then with all the breathing and everything, they themselves find out, you know, when if they give up, if they don't smoke, they are able to do much better breathing. So they give it up, or at least it's reduced to some limit. I remember one incident where this person had severe headache. I mean, migraine, vomiting, and all kinds of things. And he's been to so many doctors, and he came to sir. And sir did the Nadi thing, and I mean, I'm really fascinated by his magic, you know, because for me, Menaka used to make fun of me. I used to tell her to get an appointment with sir, I'm not well. Then she would say, what is it to you? He'll just take your Nadi and you'll say, I'm all right now. So it, you know, like he had that power of healing which used to pass through the Nadi, I think. But he did the Nadi and all that, and then he was observing him, and then he just said, sir, he was wearing glasses, you know, spectacles. He said, could you take it off? So he took it off, and then he checked the glasses, and then he said, these glasses are too tight. So do you have a spare pair? So he said, yes. He said, wear it. And the next class he came, he said, his headache had gone. You know, it's, I mean, it's so wonderful, you know, like so many, I wish I had recorded all these things. We had another very fat lady, she always had back pain. And she said, when I lie down, I can't get up, you know, when I get up, I have terrible pain. So he said, just show me how you lie down. And she lies down on the floor with a mat. And she gets up like that, just sits up. So he said, is it possible for you to you know, turn to one side and use your hand to, like the right way we do now. And the second class, the lady came, she had no back pain because it was just the straining of the back, you know. And she didn't leave yoga, she continued doing yoga to lose weight. So, I mean, I can go on and on like this anecdote, it's getting late. I just want to say, what attracted me and what has kept me with him even now. I was telling Kaustubh also, even now to go and see him, a part of me dies each time. I see a person who was like a, I don't know, like a lion or the king of the jungle or something like that. He was like a larger than life person to us, to me personally. And to see him like that, it's painful. But then I feel, I mean, everybody has said, they have all said also, when people close to him come and visit him, he feels better. He senses people coming and visiting him and all that, so he's better. So we steel ourselves and go and visit him. He very large-hearted. He was a very, very large-hearted person. If you know, like, he's a type of person, if he saw you without something, he would take off his shirt and give it to you. He's that kind of a person. He didn't bother. We go to his house, he has to give you something. Poor Menaka would have cooked something and kept, he'll come and give that to us. And they would be without food, you know, like, it was, I've experienced it in some other people, but it was a unique, he's a very unique individual. I have been very fortunate to have very close association with such an individual. And they say that what you can leave behind in the world is to make a difference in the world, and that he has done. It was basically what I could do at that time. So this hand was, the mobility was only so much. So I had to use this hand to lift it up, you know. Of course, what applies to me may not apply to anybody else, but just a few seated ones and a few standing with this hand against the wall. And each time I had to go a little higher. That would be the next class. And I came very often, like every 5 days I was coming to see sir. So my husband's, I don't remember. It was about 25 years back. So I really don't remember what he did. And I don't know whether he's doing is what he has taught him also. He does something and it's not in me to go and tell that's not the right thing. So, but he's happy, he said my elbow is 100%, so when something good is happening, leave it. Never touch it. Yeah. A lot of breathing. He gave me, during, you're interested in his course during my cancer treatment.
Yes.
Yeah. A lot of breathing. With a lot of exhalation, with krama. I had to do Mahamudra a lot. And then all the back arches I did, because there is a lot of heat produced by all the treatments. Radiation and chemotherapy produces a lot of heat in your body. But you have to do certain back arches, you know, to for your body. So I used to do all that on chants. And he made me focus on Gayatri because the sun is a healing factor. So I had to chant Gayatri when I'm doing Bhujangasana. So it's always done on exhalation. So the heat effect is reduced. He didn't introduce Om for me for a long time. I never had to say Om. You know, so it was always Ayurdehi. It was never Om Ayurdehi, never. Just Ayurdehi, for me alone. Just, you keep quiet, then they'll say, and then I have to take over. so much of freedom that way, you know, Sid. So much of love and care, Sid, isn't it? But we were a small group of people, so I think that was possible. I teach in one, I teach yoga to a group of Muslim ladies, and I've been wondering whether I'm doing the right thing, but at least they are doing yoga. So I think that, yeah, that is a big thing. But I cannot use any sound. I cannot say O or Ma, because we know you're trying to make us say this. So there's no sound, only breathing. So they are interested in doing all that, whatever they see, that Ramdev and so many people on the TV. They get up at 4 o'clock and they do all that. But they are fascinated to know that a Muslim lady teaches yoga. So I mean, on and off, one or two females with the burqa and all, they come. And so I mean, but it's a very frustrating experience, because they will ask, what is the name of this posture? If you say it's warrior posture, oh, we can't do it. So.